Hi guys, welcome to the Spotlight Kid. Today I'm going to shine the spotlight on a fantastic band from Sarasota, Florida, called Crimson Glory. Crimson Glory, who in my opinion released in the 1980s two of the best classic heavy metal and early prog metal albums ever made. Before sadly, you know, slipping into an almost total obscurity. They had a few attempts over the years at a resurgence, but never with any real success, unfortunately, and for various reasons. You know, I won't go through the whole history of the band here now, but you know, we'll just talk a little bit about some of that. Today, I'm going to talk about their amazing self-titled debut album, which is probably my favorite. At some point, I'll most likely tackle the second masterpiece, Transcendence, because that's also a very important album and I love it almost as much. But today we'll focus on the masterpiece that is Crimson Glory. That's the album cover there, you can see on the shirt. So a little history, guys. The band formed in Sarasota, Florida in 1979 with the name Pierced Arrow. The band would go on to have several lineup changes over the next few years. But you had from the beginning there the core guys of Ben Jackson on guitar, Dana Burnell on drums. And in that early stage, Jeff Lords would also join, although not right at the beginning, on bass. During this period, at some point, the band name changed to Beowulf. And I think at that stage, when they were Beowulf, that's when John Drenning joined on the guitar. So they went through a couple of singers before discovering the uber-talented high school buddy of Jeff Lords by the name of John Patrick McDonald, who apparently they saw singing on the beach one day or something. That's what I've read. I don't know how true that is. It might be total bullshit, but hey, it sounds good, so we'll go with that. So John Patrick McDonald would, of course, later be known by the moniker of Midnight. So with his inclusion in the band, that rounded out the classic lineup that would, around that time, once again, change the name to Crimson Glory. So with this lineup, they would actually spend the next 4 years writing and rehearsing for their debut album recorded in 1986 on Parr Records, the self-titled Crimson Glory. Just a side note as well, I believe when they signed to Roadrunner Records, which at the time was Road Racer Records, I believe, the album was reissued with that label. Anyway, so let's dive in. So the album kicks off track one, Valhalla. So straight out of the gate, this song oozes epic grandiosity. Super cool opening riff, kicks in with a great rhythmic feel, and then dual leads creep in slowly and just explode all over it. So tasty, and as soon as I hear that, I'm instantly in love. Then Midnight starts to sing, and immediately you know you're listening to someone unique and very special. I put him, I would put him right up there with Jeff Tate, Rob Halford, and even Dio, because I love when singers bring something unique, and that's what you get with Midnight. He has this incredible range and highs he gets, but it's all laced with a ton of emotion and drama, which gives the music all that extra excitement and oomph. So anyway, they move through the various movements of the song, which is, you know, put together really well, by the way, and leading to, you know, Midnight's wailing Valhalla chorus and into the great guitar solo. Super tasty stuff, and Midnight gives us an ear-exploding scream to wrap up as the band finishes with a dual guitar lead riff. Super awesome. You know, what a great album opener. Doesn't get much better than that. So then you've got Dragon Lady, track two. This one starts with an almost Merciful Fate style riff and sort of that King Diamond-esque scream and evil laugh. And again, we get a prime slab of Jewel guitar tastiness to lead into the verses, which has this kind of, again, Fate, Merciful Fate, Iron Maiden style of groove, and then leads into a great catchy chorus. Crimson Glory are another band that writes these great, memorable, catchy choruses and songs in general. Anyway, so then we have this lead riff build up moving into the solo. Again, super tasty. Midnight then shows us his best Halford impression to bring us back to the chorus, and damn, it's insane. What a crazy voice he has, and it's awesome. So we get more wailing for Midnight and more Jewel guitar awesomeness to wrap up. Just another home run of a track. Then we get to track 3, Heart of Steel. So Heart of Steel starts off with this beautiful acoustic passage with, again, the great harmonized Jewel guitar floating above into the melancholy emotion of the verse. More tasty leads and eventually building up to crack into the rocking chorus. Again, it's super catchy, it's very memorable. The rest of the song keeps that pace and feel. And for me, it just seems like these guys, they must have had epicness just spilling out of their pockets all over the studio at the time, because it just has that grand power. Anyway, the production, it's very reverby, but personally I love that about this album. It really suits the music and just accentuates everything and adds to the drama, I think. Anyway, so we come out of the chorus into this kicking bridge and shredding solo that wraps up with more Jewel guitar lead harmonies. I just love all the Jewel guitar leads on this album. It's one of my favorite things in metal, and these guys obviously love it too, and they do it perfectly. So, if you like that kind of thing, you're in for a treat. So anyway, it goes back to the verse and chorus to wrap it up, and it's just so bloody good. Then we get to the next track, Azrael. Azrael starts with another elegant acoustic section with a heavy sort of choir choral pad, creating a doomy intensity over the top. Midnight begins with plenty of emotion-laced vocals, and eventually leads to kind of like a stop and a reconfiguration into another Maiden-esque groove, which is sort of kicked off by more Jewel lead harmonies. What a surprise. All through the verse, we're treated to more bursts of lead guitar magic and Midnight's unique coolness. The chorus is, of course, memorable and epic. Again, the solo once again kicks ass. This fan favorite is another example of how well they combine kick-ass metal with a classy elegance and drama and a perfect, seamless expression. It's just a great, great, great track. Then we come to track 5, Mayday. Here we have a slightly dissonant Jewel leads this time to kick us off, and then it takes us into this fast barn burner of a track. This song is more direct and to the point, with less of the complex arrangement that the previous songs had. Nevertheless, though, it's a total ripper. Midnight's shrieking chorus reminds me a lot of Jeff Tate, and this song reminds me of kind of like a heavier version of Queensryche in the EP era. So if you like that kind of thing, I think you'd like this track. Of course, there's no shortage of blistering guitar work, and again, the band is just a tight, unstoppable force of nature here. Anyway, we move on to track 6, Queen of the Masquerade. So, you know, we go from this fast-paced onslaught of Mayday to the slower mid-paced feel here with those sort of fiery harmonized guitars all over it, leading into a lead break over the top of a very almost 80s hair metal groove. But unlike most hair metal bands, these guys know how to do it right, you know. The feel changes into the pre-chorus and chorus. They go back to a sort of more traditional heavy metal vibe there. They go back through the verse chorus again with the cool lead lines. This time under the verse vocals is these cool lead lines. The guitar solo is total 80s metal awesomeness. But I love it, and it rocks hard nonetheless. It's just awesome. The intro leads return, and then the song sort of goes into this cool, almost funky bass groove to lead us back to the last pre-chorus and chorus. You know, I'll say that there are elements in this song that, if done by other bands at the time, I would probably be less than complimentary about it. But these guys nail it, and it's yet another perfect track of this stellar album. So that brings us to track 7, Angel of War. Angel of War opens with keyboards, choirs, and a prayer, and then kicks into another sort of Maiden-esque groove. And unusually, actually, we get to Midnight's verse before any guitar harmonies. Midnight's, you know, it's another passion-drenched performance from Midnight here too. The pre-chorus uplifts the song and into the elegant and epic chorus, which again is catchy and memorable. All of these songs are super memorable. When you look at the album titles, you can hear the song, and that's a mark of great songwriting. So finally, we get a short burst of lead guitar just to remind you that you're still listening to a Crimson Glory song. Can't have Crimson Glory without that. One thing I haven't mentioned is the lyrics. So, you know, throughout the whole album, Midnight gives us very poetic and thought-provoking stuff. And for those of you who love lyrics, you know, you're in for a treat. I don't mention lyrics much because I'm more of a music guy. I usually listen to the singer as kind of another instrument. So, you know, to my detriment, I often miss great lyrics, but I thought it was important to mention it here because they're there and they're great. Anyway, so the song sort of goes down a few different tangents before wrapping up with a fantastic chorus and outro bass groove and harmonies. It's another absolute winner. Anyway, finally we get to track 8, Lost Reflection. So we get an extremely melancholy and emotional performance from Midnight, wailing away over a sort of slow, dreamy acoustic and keyboards. The subject matter is totally something you can imagine King Diamond singing about, though. It's this evil guy being held captive in an attic, getting, you know, lost in the shadows and darkness. Maybe there's a meaning I'm missing there, but for me, it seems totally like King stuff. Maybe Midnight was a King Diamond fan, or a Merciful Fate fan. Who knows? Sounds like it to me here. Anyway, there's a brief moment sort of when the band all kicks in for a little sort of heavy passage, but then it falls away again, and the music fades out, this time with kind of a reverse tape loop of the kind of like the beginning of the song, and Midnight talking to himself as the madman in the attic. This is probably my least favorite song on the album, but I still love it for its weirdness and for the passionate performance Midnight gives, which really carries the whole song. Anyway, so that wraps up the album. So how would I rate this one? Well, people often talk about perfect albums, and for me, This is definitely one of them. I would give this one easily 10 out of 10. And you know, I couldn't recommend this album and this band highly enough. So if you haven't heard this one, go out, watch it on YouTube, buy it. All their albums are good. But this one and the next one, in particular Transcendence, are must-haves for any fans of classic heavy metal and early prog metal. Anyway, folks, that's it for today. Thanks, everyone, for watching, and like and subscribe if you feel so inclined and you like what you saw. So for me, the Spotlight Kid, keep it metal, and see you next time.